Hello and welcome back to Microsoft Mechanics Live. Today we're going to take a look at the infusion of AI and data visualization using Power BI and the latest in enterprise scale reporting, including some things like AI-generated automated insights, first-time native integration with cognitive services as you query your data, new extensibility option if you're a data scientist, and advances in reporting against big, big data sets, as well as the ability to visualize SSRS reports within Power BI and interact with them, and even more. To do that, I'm joined by Justyna Lucznik from the Power BI team. Give her a big welcome.
Thank you. It's good to be on the show.
Thank you. So it's the first time on the show.
Yes.
And we have an awesome audience here that are all using Power BI, it sounded like. So we're seeing more and more services really across Microsoft taking in artificial intelligence and AI, and Power BI is really no exception to that, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So we're thinking carefully about how we can take core Power BI capabilities, like data visualization and data modeling, and really combine them with AI to create these immersive experiences. And I really think we're taking things to the next level. We're catering for all of our different Power BI users, ranging from the business users to the analysts and to the data scientists. So for our business users, as a user interacts with their report, we're going to have machine learning reason over the data and surface interesting insights. As an analyst, you can directly apply AI enrichments like cognitive services during your smart data prep. And as a data scientist with Python integration in a product, you can now more easily use machine learning to experiment and visualize on top of your data.
So again, whether you're just a Power BI user or a data scientist, AI really becomes, in many respects, more accessible, and you can even, can you walk us through actually some examples here?
I bet everybody
wants to see a demo of this.
Yeah, so let's start with our business user and automated insights. So here we have a report about Hawaii tourism. And generally, as a business user, what I do inside Power BI and slice and dice my report to try and uncover some hidden trends. But what we're doing with Power BI is we're trying to automate finding insights for you. So over here, I'm looking at visits by date, and I see this sort of drop in visits in US West. And what I can do with Power BI is simply right-click on the visual, select Analyze, and explain the decrease. And Power BI is going to automatically find interesting insights for me here.
And the red's probably not a good thing there, right?
No. Those are the dips.
Okay.
And over here, we also, as of August, are allowing you to ask questions directly from inside a Power BI report. So I can click on this button over here, and we automatically see some suggested questions prepared for by our analysts.
And this is really cool, because before, if you're a Power BI user, this is something that you did kind of at the top level of your Power BI dashboard, and you do that from the browser as opposed to from the desktop client.
Yeah, so we're trying to make the Q&A experience a lot more intuitive.
Okay.
So I can, of course, you know, type in my natural language questions. Imagine I want to look for something like visits by trip purpose.
Okay.
Power BI is going to plot this automatically for me. But something new that's coming into the product that hasn't been released yet is this concept of asking a follow-up question. So Power BI retains the context of my question, and I can ask a natural language question, or Power BI actually uses the same insights engine to proactively prompt me with questions that might be interesting to me. So I can, for example, ask what affects this distribution, and Power BI gives me automatic insights.
Very cool. So directly within Power BI, you're getting kind of machine learning generated insights, even trying to predict the next question. If you're using Excel, and I think a lot of people probably are, it looks a little bit similar to the ideas capability, some of the insights that we can do in Excel. We're actually finding data points that are interesting as part of your data sets. Now, we saw that also demonstrated recently with Jack Elmore when we showed all the different AI capabilities within Office. So how does this differ from Excel?
Yeah, so this uses very similar machine learning capabilities in the back end. So you know, you're going to see more and more synergy coming between our self-service products, with Power BI, of course, being the most advanced.
OK, no bias. No. OK, so you mentioned also new support for data analysts. And there's probably a lot of data analysts out here. So what are you doing there?
Yeah, so this is where we're really combining the power of Power BI, with the Azure ecosystem to unlock some amazing experiences.
Okay.
So continuing with our Hawaii storyline, over here we have a data set and a report that is looking at hotel reviews.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see this Power BI report is kind of different from usual. It's kind
it
of odd looking.
It's very unstructured-ish in terms of the data set.
It is very unstructured-ish. So we have a bunch of natural kind of text fields over here. We have some images. And generally, in Power BI, I'm used to slicing and dicing my data. So let's see how we can use AI transforms to create some more structure for this data.
OK, let's do it.
Yeah. So let's go ahead and navigate to the Power BI service. So here you see something called a data flow. And this is going to be coming soon to Power BI. This is our self-service enterprise data prep capabilities.
Mm-hmm.
And as part of a data flow, what you can do is actually add AI insights. And so I'm going to select this button over here. And you can see when I click on AI Insights, this is going to come up with a list of functions that I can call, including things like cognitive services.
And are these some, so these are actually in box, are these something that you have to add, or is this included in this function set?
Yeah, so the cognitive services are all included in box.
Okay, very cool, very cool. And the things up on the top folder, is that something that you can add then if you've got your own models?
Yeah, so imagine you have, you know, data scientists in your organization who have built custom machine learning models. You can actually bring your Azure machine learning models directly into Power BI.
Okay, cool. So that way you can, if you add Python or something, we're going to show that, I think, in a little bit in terms of what you can do to add stuff. But how does all of this work then? How do I actually add cognitive services to some of my reports to really put some structure against that data?
Yeah, so let's take a look. So imagine, okay, you know, we have hotel reviews, as we saw inside the Power BI report. Imagine I want to actually score sentiment on top of them. All I have to do is find my text reviews field over here. I do have to select which language I have, because this is not yet released. In release, we'll actually detect the language. Mm-hmm. And all I have to do is invoke this function, wait a couple of seconds, and we're just going to create a new calculated column for you inside this data flow with all of your sentiment calculated. So you can see that right over here.
Very cool. So you can tell that an analyst then would be able to leverage all of this without needing to understand machine learning or ML or write any code, because these are all inbox, kind of really easy to call functions that are just linked to various columns that you add in your data set.
Yeah, yeah, precisely. Now, imagine we wanted to use Azure machine learning. So in this particular example, my data scientist has gone ahead and built this image classification model for doing image classification for hotel images. Mm-hmm. And so I need to just select my image column over here. Again, I just want to invoke this function, wait a couple of seconds, and you're going to see we basically have a column with a bunch of URLs over here. We can just expand this out by selecting this button over here. Wait a couple of seconds, press OK. And basically, we go through all the image URLs, we score this, and you're going to see all of the image tags appear inside my data set here.
Very cool. So does an analyst then have to apply these functions every single time they transform new data?
No, the great thing is these transforms just become Power Query steps, which all our analysts are pretty familiar with. And so every time your data refreshes, these cognitive services and Azure machine learning models will just run on top of your data. So OK, we're going back to my odd, unstructured report. And I'm going to just
some
go ahead.
Pictures there, some good and some kind of weird.
Yeah, yeah. So you know, let's actually try and analyze these.
Okay.
So I'm going to just drag over the sentiment score over here, mm-hmm. and I'm going to actually plot this by the hotel names that I have inside my data set. And you can very quickly see, you know, which hotels have high sentiment and which ones are maybe not as popular. I can click on them and cross-filter my data very easily.
Okay.
But what I can also do is bring in the image tags that the machine learning model has found. And so over here, you can see all of the different things that the machine learning model
has picked
up.
And those are just sorted alphabetically now?
Currently, yes.
Okay.
They are sorted alphabetically. But what we can also do is actually bring in the sentiment score and cross-correlate these together.
Okay.
And now they're ranked by sentiment.
Oh, I see. So it looks like AC is at the bottom and the beach is at the top. It kind of makes sense.
Yeah, yeah. So if you look at something like water view, for example, you know, you see a bunch of nice water views. But you have rightfully pointed out AC is all the way at the bottom. And if we click on AC, we see some, you know, pictures of broken, dirty, loud ACs. And you know, I guess that makes sense. If you're on holiday and you're taking a picture of an AC, there's probably something going on.
I think the last thing we want to do while we're on vacation, or even you know, while we're traveling in general, is be taking pictures of AC units. So that means we're pretty dissatisfied with our hotel.
Yes, I would say so.
Okay.
And they're also mostly coming from Hotel 4. So this is, again, kind of a question mark for me.
Right. So in this case, we saw that it actually translated both structured and unstructured data into a unified data set that we could actually start to analyze and visualize using Power BI. It's a really good practical use case in this case if you're running a hotel. Using cognitive services directly with Power BI and extending the learning and insights that it can do, even using that unstructured data set. So mm-hmm. the next level then is obviously taking AI-driven data models and bringing them into Power BI to further visualize that data and actually extend the visualization capabilities of Power BI. What can we do there to support data scientists?
Yeah. So for our data scientists, we're really looking for Power BI to be a natural integration point with other data science tools, such as R. And many data scientists, of course, also use Python. So as of October, we've introduced Python integration into the product, too. So you can now use Python scripts to connect to your data. You can plot Python visualizations. And also, you can do Python Power Query transforms. So everything that you can do with R, you can now do with Python inside the desktop. And this unlocks a ton of possibilities, ranging from you know, creating Python machine learning models and during your data prep to plotting Python visualizations, which don't exist in Power BI.
Right.
So let me actually show you
an example.
Let's
see what it looks like to use some mm-hmm. Python in this case.
Yeah. So let's flip back to this report for a second. And let's go to a new page. And in this case, I want to plot something called a swarm plot, which doesn't exist in Power BI. And I want to plot this Python script over here, which I'm just going to copy.
And of course, you've got some Python handy.
Yes, of course, for the purpose of time,
yes,
of course.
No, I know.
And so I can select this Python visualization right over here. All I have to do is do my data bindings like I would do with any other Power BI visualization. So I'm going to select my index column over here. I'm going to select season, and I'm going to select average temperatures. And what I want to plot is the spread of temperatures across seasons for Hawaii islands.
Okay.
And so I am going to go back and select my Python visual over here and add the index. And one other thing I'm going to do is make sure my data isn't summarized, because I'm really interested in plotting the spread in this specific case. So I'm just going to select the Don't Summarize buttons. OK, and now all I have to do is copy in my script over here. Let's make this a little bit bigger so that we can actually see the plot. And now I just hit run. And now Power BI is going to go ahead and run this Python script. It's going to take a couple of seconds. And it's going to basically plot me my swarm plot, which is going to be looking at bunch of seasons and the spread of temperatures.
And there it is. All right.
Yes, there it is.
Very cool. And you can even interact with this, right?
Yeah, because Power BI is all about interactivity. What I can do, for example, is select Maui as the island I'm interested in, and the Python visual will just go ahead and cross-filter.
Awesome. So a lot that we can do in terms of advancing our insights and using our data within Power BI, using machine learning. Why don't we switch gears, though, and take a look at what we're doing to support, I think, the next hottest topic other than AI.
Yes.
Big data, and lots of people have a lot of data that they're trying to slice and dice through and visualize. What are we doing there?
Yeah, so with big data sets, it used to be that analysis services and reporting services were all completely separate. What we're doing with Power BI is breaking down these silos, and we're actually bringing Azure Analysis Services directly into Power BI to offer a single self-service BI platform for enterprise reporting.
Okay.
And this is, I think, the biggest scalability feature we have ever introduced into the product.
All right, so how big does it scale?
So we are going to be hopefully showing you plotting a trillion rows of data, which is a quarter of a petabyte of data.
Very cool. Why don't you show us what it looks like? And we're going to do some things with SSRS in a bit as well, right?
Yeah. So beyond scale, we're also allowing you to very easily bring your SSRS reports directly into the Power BI service. And we'll do a demo of that, too.
All right. Let's start with what you're doing to support these massive data sets and these massive scale sets.
Mm-hmm.
You said a trillion rows.
Yes.
So I want to see you do this, because I don't know if you can do actually a trillion rows. We did a billion last time, and that was already impressive.
We did do a billion, yeah.
Show
me
a trillion.
So I'm going to try to do a trillion in 5 minutes. Okay.
Let's try to do it.
Okay. So in this particular scenario, we are looking at data coming from a smartphone app. This is looking at a courier service, and it's crowdsourced. And so we're actually emitting driver's locations. And so if we look at this location count over here, this is going to count how many rows of data we have inside this data set. And so I'm going to casually drag this onto the canvas. I'm going to make this into a card. I'm not lying to you, Jeremy.
Yes.
We have a trillion rows of data here.
1 trillion rows. Yes.
1 trillion rows, yes. And
all right, so are we going to be able to query against this, though? Because it's a lot.
Yeah. Well,
you've got time.
Let's go.
Let's
give it a try. So let's go ahead and plot something like distance traveled. We can plot it by, let's say, activity date.
Okay.
Let's go ahead and make this bigger. Let's maybe change the visualization type. Let's add something like miles per job. And let's actually drag miles into job into the legend. And so you can see, the query time is, instantaneous. It's like slicing and dicing through butter.
It just seems like you're actually querying through thousands of rows, maybe,
mm-hmm.
not trillions of rows. So what's the trick to get all this to work and be so fast in this case?
Yeah. So what we're actually doing here is we're caching the data inside Power BI like we always do, but we're actually caching the data at the aggregated layer. And this is a new feature, it's a new modeling feature called aggregations. And so this allows us to unlock these kinds of massive data sets at use essentially a fraction of the memory requirements.
Very cool. So we're able to kind of intelligently cache that. You could do a few steps in terms of getting the right cache in place. What happens then if I need to query against stuff that might not be in the cache that I've kind of set up as part of the aggregation step before this?
Yeah. OK, so let's take a look. So let's go ahead and flick this measure on. This is showing me all the drivers who have left the company. And
okay.
I'm going to just filter on December the 23rd. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to plot a driver name over here. And I'm just going to make this table a little bit smaller. And I'm going to add a distance traveled as well. And so now I'm going to go and scroll through this table and find one driver over here. So this is Abigail Johnson. So she Left the company. She drove over 50 miles on December 23rd, so I was able to kind of go down to that level. Mm-hmm. And now what I want to do is I want to actually drill through on Abigail. And I'm going to drill through into this second report page. And now we're no longer hitting the cache. We have to go against the direct query, basically. And this is going against HDI Spark. And so what you've noticed is, you know, I didn't have to go and, you know, go into some other report or do anything. It's
You're
just
not even writing HDI Spark or doing any of that stuff.
And, you know, I promise you, we can go into Spark over here, and we can refresh this page over here, and we can take a quick look and see that there's an active job that has just been kicked off.
Okay.
We can go into this. We can kind of double click, and we can see, indeed, we are running a query for Abigail Johnson.
Right.
And so, you know, this is actually two amazing enterprise reporting features coming together. The first one is composite models. So if I hover over this table over here, you see this is a direct query table operating against HDI Spark. And over here, when I hover over this, you can see this is actually an imported table. So we're able to now, in Power BI, bring you connections from both import mode as well as direct query inside one report.
And there's Abigail's travel steps and all of the different spots where she checked in, effectively.
Yes.
So very cool. So you were able to slice into data even if it wasn't cached locally. It just took a couple seconds to run. Not too shabby in terms of going through that trillion rows. So you mentioned that you can bring in also, and we did mention this, SQL Server Reporting Services reports also into Power BI. I know a lot of people are using that. In fact, I saw quite a few people here were using that. How do we bring in an existing reporting so it's interactive into Power BI?
Yeah, so over here, I'm inside my Power BI workspace, you know, like I always am. I'm going to navigate over to my reports. And what you'll notice is we actually have a new type of report icon that has appeared over here.
Okay.
And I can drill into, let's say, my employee sales summary. And these are essentially my SSRS reports appearing directly inside the Power BI service. So these are pixel perfect, paginated reports. They have interactive headers, footers, page breaks. You can export them to PDF. And, you know, all of the features is a full package directly inside the Power BI service, which, you know, I know a lot of people have been asking for.
So this was one of the things, you don't have to use copy paste and grab like a screen snip of your SSRS report and stuff it in there, because that's what a lot of people were doing, I've heard, at least. Hopefully you don't do that. But now you can actually get it to work and be interactive. So it sounds like a lot of people are actually going to be able to then get a lot of value in this case in terms of aggregating and unifying all that reporting into Power BI in terms of one place to look at both your SSRS as well as your Power BI reporting.
Yeah, and they could basically collate all their BI artifacts inside the Power BI workspace.
Very cool. So lots of great updates. Everybody like what you see here with Power BI? All right, so we're bringing all the AI and reasoning and visualizing over massive amounts of data, as we saw here. You can also use AI, and if you're new to Power BI, you can either start learning at powerbi.com or even take it to the next level. This is probably the best recommendation in terms of where you'd get started, right?
Yeah, pretty much. You know, definitely check out powerbi.com. You can find video tutorials. We encourage you to download the latest version of the Power BI desktop. And, you know, check out the blog. We always post new updates of all the new capabilities.
Thanks, Justyna. And, of course, keep watching Microsoft Mechanics as we continue to follow Power BI. That's all the time we have for this show. We'll see you next time.